I am Gabriela Ramirez Arellano.
And I am Alejandro Santiago.
As we continue to uplift the voices of the community, a common theme we encounter is our conversation around identity.
Identity is often described as the expression, appearance, personality, belief a person or group holds.
Yes, technically, but more times than not, identity is how people see or perceive us, rather than the identities we choose for ourselves.
Absolutely. We're more than outside references. It's important to highlight that we're all made of different identities, like sexual orientation, place of birth, professional identity, accents, being a parent, and so many others. And when you mix all of those together, the result is perfection. It's you.
All of that. I can't tell you how many times I've tried to be a part of spaces and places, trying to blend in while being conscious that I'm the only one at the school, in the meetings, in the spaces. It was only when I realized that I could identify as many things, not just one, that I was able to claim my space and power.
Having conversations around this topic empowers us and others to embrace who we are and move everywhere we go as ourselves. Kendall Martinez-Wright shared with us that exact same journey to self-discovery. Kendall is the fabulous glass ceiling breaker, do-it-all Afro-Puerto Rican queen of Missouri. Kendall ran a historic campaign in the Missouri State House. She used her resilience and passion to claim the power of knowing her true self.
It was emotional for me to speak with Kendall, and I really related to some of the questions that she asked herself, like, am I being Latina enough?
And to me, I related to the advocacy and everything she's done to bring a more just environment to the LGBTQIA community in Missouri.
Originally from Chicago, Kendall and her family moved to Missouri in search of a better life. They already had family roots in the small city of Palmyra, which is the county seat of Marion County near Hannibal.
Shortly after me and my sister was born, mother, she realized that Chicago, even though it was vibrant and amazing, it wasn't also exactly the atmosphere that she wanted to raise two young black children. The neighborhood we were born in was pretty dangerous. And it was during a time when Chicago was going through some really dark times in terms of gun violence and gang-related violence. And mother wanted us to make sure that we had a good upbringing.
I love black folk. Black look like a revolution. Look like a family reunion in the park.
When it comes to identity, entering new spaces and blending into them comes with a risk, and sometimes we end up erasing a little bit of who we are. For Kendall, this was a time to embrace her Puerto Rican roots and reconcile the many aspects that make her who she is.
That's what guided me to finally embracing, okay, you know what? This is who I am, and I have to make sure that his legacy lives on through me. And with the help of my mom, she was a firm supporter of making sure of that and continuing that. And overall, it helped me guide through numerous entities from me reconciling who I am as a trans woman, making me realize that, hey, look, Kendall, you are you, and you cannot, and nobody else is going to write the story of Kendall Martinez-Wright than yourself. That's what really put into play and perspective of me after high school and me after undergrad and thus forth.
I feel like sometimes we straddle that bridge because my children are biracial too. And so you straddle the challenge of not being enough. Not being black enough. Not being Mexican enough or Puerto Rican or Latino enough. You're not American enough. And so there's all these things that are coming together, and really takes a lot for you to just authentically be and get to the place where you feel this is who I am and this is the voice that I will represent. Like Kendall, many of us have to assimilate in one way or another, not finding a happy medium in either identity.
When I go to the cookout, you know, on my mom's side of the family, you know, it's like sometimes I have to drop the Martinez portion or the Puerto Rican side of me. And then when I, you know, go to like the Puerto Rican Day celebration somewhere in the city, you know, I gotta drop the black side of me. And it's like, Kendall, you don't have to drop both sides of who you are. Just call them as you are and let people know, like, hey, look, you're fabulous, you're Afro-Latina, and if anybody says anything, you're going to fuss at them like your aunt would do is you got into some trouble.
Amidst nationwide transphobic legislation in 2021, Kendall ran a historic campaign for Missouri's 5th District. She has a long career in advocacy, politics, and legislative work.
The campaign's website was even admitted to the Library of Congress as she became the first Afro-Puerto Rican transgender woman to run for Missouri's legislature. When we come back, we learn more about Kendall's historic campaign, her interest in getting involved in politics,
what drove her to end her quest for the Capitol seat, and what the future looks like for her.
From St. Louis Public Radio and PRX, this is
We Live Here,
Auténtico.
I got involved in high school, and I was affiliated with a few clubs in high school, but it wasn't until after when I really got into it was the murder of Michael Brown Jr. in St. Louis.
On August 9, 2014, Michael Brown Jr., an 18-year-old black man, was fatally shot by the then 28-year-old white Ferguson police officer, Darren Wilson, in the city of Ferguson, Missouri. Protests ensued in Ferguson and soon spread across the country.
I was there when he was killed. I was actually at a friend's house a few blocks away from where he stayed at. And I remember that time so vividly because it was really 2 years after, it was 2 years after Trayvon Martin died. Mm-hmm. And I remember I was protesting in my high school, and I actually got suspended in high school for protesting the murder of Trayvon Martin. And so it kind of really resonated on me that racism and various institutions of the post-colonial America really struck with me and everything. So that's what really got me involved overall, and then me coming to terms of who I am as an individual, being a member of the LGBTQ community. I remember in 2015, shortly after the SCOTUS decision, I had people say, oh, Kendall, you'll be able to get married. I'm like, yeah, but there's other things that we are still fighting for. And really getting people to recognize that, yes, marriage was a huge stepping stone, but when we have over, at the time, 30 states that didn't have any type of protections in regards of housing, employment, and whatnot for the LGBTQ community, it made me realize that there is a lot of work we still have to do, and it's a motivator of me being able to have not only those uncomfortable conversations with elected officials, but also be in the community and letting people know, like, the work doesn't stop here. Mm-hmm. This is just the beginning of a long haul of work.
According to the Human Rights Campaign, the largest LGBTQ advocacy group in the U.S., 2022 is on track to set the record for the most anti-transgender bills ever. Overall, more than 300 anti-LGBTQ+ bills have been proposed in 2022. In fact, there are currently several bills being discussed in the Missouri legislature as well. The Trevor Project's 2021 national survey found that 42% of LGBTQ+ youth have seriously considered attempting suicide in the last year. And for transgender and non-binary youth, that number increased to 52%.
The main reason why there has been all of a sudden, especially these past 3 to 4 years of these anti-trans bills and legislation, is the fact that the trans community has always been here in the United States. That's point blank, period. It is us really coming to light of recognizing that we are here and that we are really taking a stance on making sure that our lives isn't dictated or policed. And a lot of people, when they hear the word transgender, they get scared. Because they don't know. 9 times out of 10, they probably haven't even met a person who is trans or who have even had contact with somebody who is trans, or not even knowing that they had contact with somebody who's trans. And it's a mixture of fear-mongering and ignorance is what's leading these bills.
Kendall is in the center of all of this and has a call for action.
One of the biggest things that people need to do, and this is kind of like my call to action, is to educate. Mm-hmm. Educate yourselves. There is a plethora of resources and various other means of educational pieces. And take time to actually read. Mm-hmm. Take time to actually listen to somebody who is part of the trans community. Mm-hmm. Far too often we see people saying, oh, we hear you. But if last year we had over almost 60 trans women to be murdered, specifically black trans women and brown and Latin trans women, there's an issue. Mm-hmm. There's a huge issue that we have to discuss. And the modern day LGBTQ movement did not start out as white gay men striving for equality. They were actually the first ones who turned down the black and brown trans women who led those protests. They were the ones that screamed, we should not have to come out. We're scared about losing our jobs, losing everything that they know. Mm-hmm. And it was the black and brown trans women, as well as the black and brown lesbians, who really truly took a stand and say, hey, we are here. We are not going nowhere because we pay our taxes. And at the end of the day, you must recognize this. You don't have to agree with anything, but just recognize us as citizens of the United States of America. Mm-hmm. And that's pretty much what we need to let people know about.
Kendall's journey is far from over, and it hasn't been easy. She continues to lead authentically and be an example for perseverance. The ball is in our court. It is up to us. How will we continue to navigate the relations that we have with others? It's important to listen, learn, and support. When we come back, Kendall walks us through one of the most challenging times of her life, while at the same time accomplishing one of the most successful moments of her career.
This is
We Live Here, Auténtico.
Hi. This is Jade Harrell, Director of On Demand and Content Partnerships.
This episode of We Live Here Auténtico includes a first-person account of someone who considered death by suicide. It may not be suitable for all audiences. Listener discretion is advised.
In 2021, Kendall Martinez-Wright, the first transgender woman to run for Missouri's legislature, announced she was suspending her campaign in a letter to all her supporters.
I'm looking forward to running for office in the near future, but right now, in my heart, mind, and soul, my mental health is more important than campaigning. I thank everyone who has supported me, guided me, and donated to this effort. I am truly blessed by this experience, and I will remember this campaign. Kendall for Missouri, House of Representatives for District 5, for the duration of my career and life.
After being diagnosed with bipolar disorder, along with the pressures of running as an Afro-Puerto Rican transgender woman in rural Missouri, she dropped out of the race. We asked her what has changed since that letter came out in 2021.
There isn't really anything I would change. I think it was very transparent. I'm pretty private when it comes to me, myself, and I, to everybody else. If I'm going through something, I will masquerade it to the fullest. But one of the things I do wish I could shed light on is drug abuse. So actually, when I was clean for almost 6 years, some substances, and I actually relapsed during my campaign. It was in April is when I relapsed. It went on for quite a bit, and it stems from my bipolar disorder. If anybody knows bipolar disorder, when you are on a manic, especially if you're type 1, which is more the mania proponent of bipolar, you will do whatever to keep you at that high. And that's what I did. And it wasn't until a little bit after my suicide attempt was when I realized, Kendall, you need help, further help. And in October, I am so proud. October of last year, I went to my therapist and to my counselor and to my psychiatrist. I was like, I want to be clean. And now we are celebrating. This will be my 7th month sober. It feels amazing. It feels amazing. I realize that I feel much healthier. Now, every now and then, I still have my drink. But, like, when I tell you, my mania, like, I still have my moments. I tell people, like, if you see me having a moment, just let me be. I will be okay. But I can say without a shadow of a doubt, I feel so much better because I really had to dive deep within myself, which I didn't do a lot during that time. I had to really dive deep and actually kind of, in a way, bring healing from other traumas that I had to deal with, that I dealt with, and other entities that I had, battles that I had to deal with, which was something huge because it took me to do it. Nobody didn't really have to push me. I had to make that decision. I think that was one of the best decisions.
It's really great to have these conversations. Although they're difficult, they must shine a light into these issues. Even though we're going through hard times, just like Kendall, how do we push through?
Especially in the Black and Brown communities, where mental health is not always something that we talk about, and we often experience other adversities such as poverty and discrimination within policies and institutions. This just adds so much to the stigma that prevents us from getting help.
And I feel like there has been a shift, and we're starting talking about it more. Look at Simone Biles. When she was at the peak of her career, she decided to take a step back because of her mental health, and it triggered so much conversation and criticism because she put herself first.
Just like Simone Biles, Kendall decided to put her mental health as a priority, and in the middle of her historic campaign, she decided that it was time to put herself first, and she is affirmed by the legacy she leaves that she made the right choice.
Mainly, it was to hopefully motivate that one individual who lives in rural Missouri that is wondering who they are, or really raising awareness to the visibility that's needed. I really want to show that, hey, look, I am living in small town USA, and I took the initiative to run because real people are concerned about real issues. None of that fake mess, but making sure that the schools can stay open 5 days a week, making sure that the roads ain't falling apart while they're driving on them, making sure that they get good health care. That's the stuff that real people are concerned about.
Being your true self is empowering, liberating, and authentico. And for Kendall, authentico means
really truly embracing the good, the not so good, and the in-between. I am a firm believer that when you are truly living authentica, you are showing who you are to everybody, whether it's through the smile you give to the average Joe or Jane down the street, to even the struggles you go through. You are showcasing that you are still standing and you are truly striving to continuing to evolve into a bigger, better person than you was before. I think that's what being authentic means to me.
Gracias, Kendall. We so enjoyed talking to you. You can find Kendall on Twitter at KendallKahnEMW. And of course, you can find us at St. Louis Public Radio.
We Live Here is a production of St. Louis Public Radio. If you are in crisis or looking for help, you can talk to a certified listener with the National Suicide Prevention Lifeline by calling 1-800-273-8255. The National Suicide Prevention Lifeline is a hotline for individuals in crisis or for those looking to help someone else. To speak with a certified listener, call 1-800-273-8255. The Crisis Text Line is a texting service for emotional crisis support. To speak with a trained listener, text HELLO to 741-741. It is free, available 24/7, and confidential. Music credit, Tank and the Bangas, Black Folk, and Mood Forever, Beyonce. Additional music from Life Creative, the music service provider for St. Louis Public Radio. Find out more about our guests, get show notes and more information, and of course, check out our previous episodes at stlpr.org. St. Louis Public Radio is a member-supported service of the University of Missouri, St. Louis.
And from St. Louis Public Radio and PRX, this is
We Live Here,
Auténtico.
Support for this podcast comes from the Corporation for Public Broadcasting.
From PRX.